Welcome once again to yet another program from the AIOS headquarters, as well as Nethradhama Hospital Private Limited. And it is my pleasure to yet again be with you on a second Surginar. And we are thankful to Dr. Sri Ganesh, who is the Chairman and Managing Director of Nethradhama Hospitals Private Bangalore. And his OT is going to be live for the next 1.5 hours. Dr. Sri Ganesh, we are going to be live for the next 1.5 hours from Dr. Sri Ganesh's operation theatre, and he's the Chairman and Managing Director of Nethradhama Hospital Private Limited, Bangalore. He's been in the forefront of the latest technologies for phacoemulsification and refractive surgeries, with several fellowships, awards and gold medals to his credit. He has performed more than 1.25 lakh cataract and refractive surgeries and has trained more than 200 fellows on phacosurgery. We've seen him on live surgeries before, almost at every forum, whether it was national or international. And the topic today is small pupil phacoemulsification. And he's going to show us on how to tackle small pupil cases using different techniques and devices, which include the nylon hooks, the metal ring, the Bhattacharya ring, as well as the viscomydriasis with high viscosity OVDs. So over to Dr. Sri Ganesh for his case description.
Thank you, Dr. Namrata and Dr. Rajesh. I welcome you all, good afternoon, and I welcome you all to this Surginar conducted by AIOS and J&J. And I welcome you to Nethradhama Hospitals. We are in Janagar now. We are in my operating theater, and I will be demonstrating some cases of small pupil and management of small pupil. Small pupil is a challenge for phacosurgeons because of the limited exposure, and there are various methods of dealing with a small pupil, and we will demonstrate few of them today. The most important aspect, especially for residents, is you have to know how to assess, and the preoperative assessment is very important. You will have to look at the maximal pupillary dilatation, look for other signs like pseudo-exfoliation, posterior sinicae, any signs of uveitis, which is responsible for the small pupil. You will also take a history, detailed history, which includes a history of diabetes, because diabetics, you can have small pupil. Again, senile meiosis is the commonest in diabetic retinopathy, but you also have a lot of patients who are on tamsulosin, and these cases are the ones which can cause intraop difficulty, because not only you have a small pupil, but you have a floppy iris syndrome, and that makes surgery difficult, and you will have to use devices in these cases and proper viscoelastic. So taking a proper history, doing a pre-op assessment is very important. Now we will go on to the cases, and I think the first case. Yeah. The first patient is a 72-year-old male. Shift the patient, please. And we are operating on his left eye. You can, again, depending upon your comfort level, you can either use a block topical anesthetic. Using topical anesthesia, then it's better to use intracameral anesthetic. This is a patient, you can see that he has a mid dilating eccentric pupil. Light, Chudandi, light, look at the light. Light, Chudandi. So here I am operating under topical. Is the view clear? Can you see? Is it focused?
Very well, yeah. Focused and very clear for us.
Okay, good. So now this is a case which is mid-dilating and eccentric. It's about a 5.5 millimeter pupil. So these are cases where you can manage with pharmacological dilation and viscomydriasis. So I'm doing a topical clear corneal incision. First I make the side port, a 1 mm side port. And this is a temporal clear corneal incision. I'm using 1% xylocaine, preservative-free xylocaine. Light, Chudandi. The patient will have a little...
Dr. Sri, do you have any experience regarding the phenocaine that people have brought?
Yes, I tried it. You can use phenocaine, or you can use even adrenaline. I just put 2 to 3 drops in a 5 ml syringe and you can use that, or you can use any of the commercial available. The most important thing is you pressurize the chamber. You pressurize the chamber when you inject xylocaine and adrenaline, and that's when you get the dilatation. If the eye is soft, then you don't have dilatation. This is Helon 5. So Helon 5 is a high viscosity OVD. It's a cohesive viscoadaptive OVD. You can see it's 23 milligrams per ml. And this helps to expand the pupil, what we call viscomydriasis. So you go to the 6 o'clock position and then inject. And you can see it's a heavy viscoelastic. And as you keep injecting, can you see that the pupil is dilating? So this much dilatation is adequate. If you get about 5 millimeter, it is adequate to do the surgery. So I'm using a 26 gauge needle to do the capsular rexus. Here you aim for a 5 to 5.5 mm rexus for phaco. So you can see that I am going near the pupillary margin.
So you used Helon 5 in this case, but do you think if you don't have access to Helon 5, Helon GV would also achieve the same, and probably Helon would also achieve a similar amount of dilatation, or maybe slightly less than this?
Slightly less than this. You get the best heavy viscoelastic. The viscoadaptive viscoelastic is the best. Of course, when doing the rexus, it kind of gives us a little than HP. You can see I've got a 5 millimeter rexus. Then you have to remove a little bit of the viscoelastic so that the eye is not too hard. So there is space to do hydrodissection. So that's a hydrodissection. You can see the posterior fluid wave. You see the nucleus rising. Decompress and rotate. Pick up. Light, Chudandi. So I'm doing a direct chop here. Bury into the center and then crack the nucleus through and through. In a small pupil, a direct chop is more advantageous than the other technique, even chop and chop, because when you're sculpting, there's a chance that you can catch the pupillary margin if you are. So once you actually separate a quadrant, I bring it up and I emulsify it. Again, there are different schools of thought regarding phaco parameters. Some people like to reduce their flow rate when they are dealing with a small pupil, but that will reduce the followability. But it is safer because the pupil will not, the iris will not suddenly come into your pupil.
but I prefer to have a higher flow rate and stay in the center so that the followability is good and I'm able to get the pieces into my echo tip. This is like a great three nucleus. So I removed one half.
At this point in time, what are your parameters when you are coming to the last bit?
See, last bit you can reduce your meters. I am at 600 vacuum and 60 flow rate.
So do you modify it or you just manage with your foot pedal control?
I manage foot pedal control. You can see that I am giving intermittent FACO. Mm-hmm. So you can see the chamber is quite stable. Mm-hmm. If I feel the I see that the posterior capsule is moving up, then I just reduce the parameters. I would probably reduce the flow rate and also the vacuum.
I think this is the advantage also of the high-end machines such as Signature Pro, where till the last fragment, the chamber, you know, remains absolutely formed and there's hardly any surge.
For IA, I'm using the coaxial IA with a high flow rate. You can also use the bimanual. The bimanual is advantageous in small pupils because you can retract the pupil and see the cortex and aspirate the cortex. But if you have a high flow rate, then you're able to do the... See, you should be careful not to catch the iris there. You just catch the frill of cortex. And since the flow is on linear, I can adjust the amount of flow. That's the subincisional cortex. That's the little bit of cortex that was remaining there.
So what is the normal preference? You prefer bimanual or you prefer coaxial?
I prefer a coaxial because I don't have to make one more incision.
Yeah.
And the chamber is more stable. I can have a higher flow rate. With a bimanual, you cannot have a high flow rate. Mm-hmm. So you have to literally take your... This is hydro polish. I'm polishing the posterior capsule with a 27 gauge cannula and also irrigating the fornices. So this also reduces your incidence of PCO and any small fibers like that, it comes out. You can see that? That little bit of... Because you cannot see exactly if there is any remaining. So this is a good maneuver to do. You can
just... scratching the posterior capsule so that you can clear whatever cells are there on the capsule.
Yes, see, now you can see it's very clear.
Absolutely nice red glow, beautifully visible.
Yeah. And now I'm going to inject the lens. For injecting the lens, it's a foldable lens, so there's no issue. You can go and inject it into the capsular bag. Just see that you're in the bag.
This is which intraocular lens?
This is the Technis 1 intraocular lens.
Monofocal Technis 1 intraocular lens.
Monofocal. So the Technis 1 has a negative aspheric optic for better quality of vision, night vision especially. Removing Helon 5 again, it's a heavy viscoelastic. So you have to use a high flow rate. And you have to spend some time in evacuating Helon 5. This is the rock and roll technique where you kind of move the lens side to side so that you can evacuate any viscoelastic. You can also go underneath the IOL. This is going underneath the IOL and aspirate. If you find that there is more viscoelastic, see, you can aspirate. Sometimes the haptic comes out, like in this case, so you can just push it back. So I've aspirated most of the viscoelastic. It's very important not to leave behind the helon 5 in the eye as much as possible. Otherwise, you will have an IOP spike.
So how would you compare Shri Ganesh evacuation of helon GV versus helon or say Visceron?
Helon GV comes out as a bolus and it's very fast to evacuate, whereas helon 5 needs a little more time to remove, and the other visco-dispersive viscoelastic would need more IA, unlike helon or helon GV. So helon 5 also, you can see the striae in the posterior capsule. Let me just zoom it up. Can you see the folds in the posterior capsule?
So that
indicates that there's no visco in the bag. You have removed the complete visco and it is clear. So that is the end of the first surgery. This is dilatation with, this is for mid-dilating pupils which are around 5 millimeters. You can dilate with adrenaline and xylocaine and use viscomidriasis.
That was perfect, Shri Ganesh. And
thank
that was
you.
Very quick also. Very quick and perfect. Would you comment on your, I saw that you were using a lit speculum which has got, which is different from the normal wire speculum that people use. Yeah. So would you like to comment on the lit speculum that you use?
Yeah, I like to use a solid blade speculum because this keeps eyelashes away also and the patient cannot squeeze. In a lit speculum, the patient can squeeze and because there is a spring-like action and then this increases the intraocular pressure. With a solid blade speculum, once you open it completely, it's a screw type. So it does not close when the patient tries to blink. So the IOP does not increase when the patient tries to blink. That's why I prefer this type of speculum. How old is the patient?
73.
Okay. Well, look at the light. 73-year-old patient, again, you can see mid-dilating pupil about 5 millimeters. So you can also do viscomidriasis in this case. I will show you a technique where if you do not want to use heavy viscoelastic, you can just do the rexis under the iris. I'm using adrenaline and xylocaine now.
So do you use adrenaline and xylocaine in all the cases?
Only in small pupils, all the cases I use it because it gives me maximum dilatation. This is just HPMC. This is stereocoaxial elimination. And in these cases, you can do the rexis light anotheric.
Any reason why you used HPMC in this case?
Because the pupillary dilatation is okay. It's about 5 millimeters. And what I'm planning here is, I just want to demonstrate, suppose you do not have access to a viscoadaptive, viscoelastic, and it is expensive.
Yeah.
So here I'm just going under the iris. Can you see?
Okay, rexis under the iris, that's what you want to demonstrate.
Yeah, this is a blind technique, but depending upon how it folds here and how the rexis is proceeding, you can make out
absolutely
whether you are okay or whether it is going off.
Yeah.
So you can see here I am just doing a rexis just under or the margin of the rexis. A margin of the pupil, and you can see that I've completed it here. You cannot see the margins of the rexis, but we have got a nice 5.5 millimeter rexis.
If we use a high viscosity viscoelastic, now we can see the margins maybe.
Yeah, I will show that.
Yeah.
So this is hydro and helon 5. So I'm putting helon 5. But once you do the hydro, the red Okay, light nodi. And I'm doing job. This is a soft. You can see soft cataracts. Again, it's difficult to chop. I do a mechanical chop. See, this is a mechanical chop. So mechanical chop is good for softer cataracts. See, this is a mechanical separation. See, mechanical separation, and then you can light notice. So you just support and then chop. This is mechanical chop, because with a softer cataract there's a chance of cheese wiring. So a soft cataract with a very soft cataract like this in an older patient, grade 2, light nodi, sir. Kalag nodi. Is a little difficult to manage the nucleus, and he's not very cooperative. He's looking up. So I'm just going to flip this half. You can see the followability is very good. Soft cataracts with a small pupil are again a challenge, because you cannot crack them very well. Light nodi. You can see the margin of the rexus now. It's fairly wide, 5.5 mm rexus. You can see again, light nodi, light nodi, light nodi. I'm doing a hydro polish again to clean the capsule. This is the safest way to clean the posterior capsule. It's a non-touch technique, and you can remove all those cortical fibers sticking to the posterior capsule and the lens epithelial cells. So you have a very clean PC. And even when you're flushing, the equatorial cells also can get dislodged, and your incidence of PCO is less. This is again a Technis One lens.
Correct. So do you normally do this hydro vacuuming in all your surgeries?
Yes, I do it routinely in all my patients, and I find that that reduces the PCO rate. And the PC is very clean, and it is safer than doing a vacuum polish or a polish with a Nightingale's polisher, because it's a non-touch technique. So that is the end of the surgery, and you can see the lens.
Do you use moxifloxacin intracamerally or in your cases, or
We used to use moxifloxacillin, but now we have stopped. We don't use anything.
So you just put topical antibiotic drops at the end of the surgery?
Yes.
Okay.
We don't patch the eye, so they start using the drops. Surgery has gone on well. Thank you, sir.
Wonderful.
Thank you so much.
Very nicely done.
Thank you so much, Sri Ganesh. Next, so what is the next case, Sri Ganesh? Are we using nylon hooks or Malugan ring? Or
I'll be showing that. This is a 82-year-old male with pseudo exfoliation and a small pupil.
Just one second. We don't have the microscope signal, so we are just waiting for that.
Yes. The patient is being shifted.
Yes, now we have the microscope signal. So there is a question which has come meanwhile when you start the case, and that is, what is the size of your corneal tunnel that you make, the size of the incision? And another question is, how do you prepare adrenaline and xylocaine combination?
Yeah, the size of the tunnel which I use is around 2.65. And the adrenaline, basically you put 2 to 3 drops of the adrenaline, draw it from the ampule, and then you can put 2 to 3 drops in BSS, 5 ml BSS, and that should be adequate. And for xylocaine, you get xylocard, which is there. So that is preservative free. That comes as 2%. You dilute it 1:1 with BSS. Light kanata, light anortha.
So you're going to use nylon hooks in this?
Yes, I will demonstrate hooks in this case. So with hooks, basically you have to make 4 incisions for the hooks. I'll just make the main incision first. And you have to use xylocaine because, again, you are handling the iris. Light and ortho. You have light and ortho. Side port. Let's go.
Yeah, this is
good. So put in viscoelastic. Side port. Hooks go.
So I'm sure, Sri Ganesh, you must be tempted to do this without nylon hooks, isn't it?
Yeah. So you make 4 small incisions, clear corneal. This much of dilatation you can probably manage. When you want to have the very...
What is the instrument that you're using to make these side ports with?
I'm using a diamond knife. But you can use the regular side port blade also.
And what's the size of that, the incision?
The size of the diamond blade is 1 mm, but I'm just making 50% of that, so about 0.5 or so.
Okay.
Just 0.5 mm. These are the hooks, nylon hooks, in the forceps. So it's got a stopper, a silicone stopper. Many people like to use the iris hooks because they are less expensive than the other devices. Let me zoom up. Again, if you deepen the AC too much, then again it will be difficult to put in the hook. So what you can do is just release a little bit of the viscoelastic. Then you will be able to hook up the... It's better to hold the elastic block. Hook it up. And then... The stopper, you just pull it. And then the opposite side, you can go to the opposite side and use the hook.
It is, I mean, of course, these hooks are not meant to be used again and again, but do you reuse them after sterilizing them for other cases?
You can eat your them. Ideally, they are disposable and have to single use. These are new hooks. So that is the two opposite hooks.
So what would be those situations, Shri Ganesh, where you would use iris hooks and not Malugan ring?
I basically use rings for either the Malugan ring or the Bhattacharya ring. And I basically personally don't like the hooks too much. Because with the hooks you have to make four extra incisions. And the other aspect is that sometimes if it's a floppy iris, then it can keep prolapsing. Also, your phacodynamics fluidics get affected, because if you have a wound leak, I mean, from these incisions, you make them very small, but sometimes you may have a leak. So that's why they are not my favorite, but they are less expensive, and this is something that many surgeons may be able to afford and use. And it's more cumbersome because
well versed with the use of the hooks than a Malugan or a Bhattacharya ring. So there's a question from Dr. Alpa Atul. She wants to know if there are any tips for incisions for these iris hooks, and any tips on size and direction.
Yeah, basically they have to be self-sealing. You shouldn't make them too long. You make them at the limbus. And you shouldn't make too large an incision. About 0.5 should be adequate. And while inserting, always you can see you insert the knee first. And here you can see you get a square type of a pupil. Now it is about, this is about say 5 millimeters by 5 millimeters. So it is adequate for the rexes.
And which viscoelastic are you using now?
This is just HPMC. Light and ortho, you can't allot speedy.
So Rajesh, do you do the hook similarly, or would your direction be a little different? Or placement be different?
I just go a little posteriorly, maybe posterior limbal, as Dr. Shri Ganesh was telling, limbal. So yes, limbal only, a little maybe posterior limbal. And I usually put two hooks just adjacent to the main incision, so that it pulls the iris tissue from, peripherally at the site of incision, so that when I take my probe inside, it doesn't rub on the iris tissue and doesn't cause any iris chafing. And normally I use 5 hooks, 2 just adjacent to the main incision, and then 3 make a diamond.
So it's a pentagon kind of a...
Pentagon kind of.
It's more like a square, so it depends. You can...
I mean, both ways it works.
Yeah, it works well. With...
So can you center it a little bit? Yeah, just a little more towards you. Perfect.
Okay.
Perfect.
Again, phaco chop.
Wonderful chop.
Again, this is a soft, not a very hard cataract. It's on the softer side.
Yeah, this is ideal, because if it's too soft, like the previous case, then you can't chop. Then it cheese wires. This is a case where it is ideal, where you have like, it's just about grade 3. So it's ideal for chopping.
So the way you do it, Shri Ganesh, everything looks very effortless, and you know, it looks as though it's happening on its own without you having to do anything.
So this is basically, once you do enough number of cases, then everything is in auto mode. So that's the last fragment there. The iris actually is pulled up, so the iris plane gets shifted. You can see the iris plane is shifted more anteriorly.
Yeah.
So you have to be careful. See, there's a big gap between the capsule and the iris here. sometimes you can have fragments go and stick there because the gap is too much.
Yes, yes.
So you have to be careful, and if there are any fragments there, then you have to kind of remove it either with viscoelastic, bring it into the center and remove it.
So anything extra you do to, you know, check that? I mean, obviously, we have to be careful while doing
it.
Anything extra?
But you can visualize, you can move the eye like this from side to side.
Okay, then
you are able to visualize. See, you are able to visualize into the periphery.
Yeah, absolutely. Excellent.
There is a question by Dr. Sanjay Sharma. He wants to know, if you want to reuse the iris hook, how do you re-sterilize the hooks?
You can re-sterilize by ETO. You cannot autoclave them because they'll melt. So you can either use plasma or ETO.
And is formalin chamber sterilization sufficient? I think that is something which we are not using now.
No. We don't recommend the formalin chamber because you don't get a sterilization. And again, you're going to compromise the sterile, because these are intraocular devices. So it's not. Formalin chamber is okay for your indirect lens and all that, something that you use externally where you just want to have some amount of sterility. But any intraocular devices, it is best either to autoclave or ETO it. In for the hooks, it is better to ETO it. Again, see, I'm doing the polishing and you can see that it is very clear. Like I said, there is a small, see, that small fragment there. Now it has come out.
Dr. Sri, there's a question from Dr. Vijay Shinde. And
yes.
He asked that, is there any role of sphincterotomy in small pupil?
Yeah, you can do sphincterotomies in a very small pupil with a fibrotic membrane. Then I suggest you do a sphincterotomy before stretching, because the other techniques are sphincterotomy and stretch pupilloplasty.
Yeah.
The sphincterotomy and stretch pupilloplasty, the stretch pupilloplasty is the easiest way if you don't have any devices. Yeah. So before you remove the viscoelastic, you have to remove the hooks. Now again, technique of removing the hooks.
I think that is very crucial, how you remove the hooks, because you know.
You turn it to one side, okay, and then you bring it out like that without distorting the wound.
Perfect.
So you just push it. You can just hold it with your MacPherson and push it like that. So it gets released. Once it gets released. Once it gets released, then you hold it to the side and rotate it. So it comes out.
So it is most important that the viscoelastic is still in while you are taking.
Yes.
While you are taking these nylon hooks out, and you don't aspirate it, because then it will become difficult to manipulate those hooks.
So this is actually removing the hooks. You should not just pull it out like that, because it can snag the wound. So you have to turn it to its side. Turn it to its side, and then, you know. See?
So, Sri, would you, if a patient wanted a multifocal intraocular lens in this, or say a extended EDO, extended depth of vision, like a symphony, would you do in these small pupil cases?
Yeah, if the pupil is as big, then it's okay. If the pupil is very small, like a 1 millimeter, 1.5 millimeter pupil, no. But once you stretch it, then the pupil would increase in size. So you can still go ahead and do it. So we have removed the hooks. Now you have to remove the viscoelastic. You can see that there is no leak from the side ports. Lens is centered well. You can go underneath the iris. There is some. Remove the visco and some pigments which are there. some of these irises have a tendency to become floppy once you stretch it or put the hooks or rings. So you have to be careful while hydrating the main incision. Always I inject towards the wall.
Dr. Sri, there's a question from Dr. Shashank Shah. And he
you can see that. Yeah. I see there is no leak either from the side ports.
Yeah.
So that is the end of the... Yes. So we'll take the question now.
Yeah. He asked whether we can use capsular hooks instead of iris hooks because they are less traumatic.
No, iris
enlargement.
No, capsular hooks are basically... they are meant to be put to support the capsule. Yeah. In cases of subluxated lenses,
they
are much more expensive and not required, and they are much longer. So they don't, they can, and the angulation is different. So it's not ideal to use them for as iris hooks.
Absolutely.
So another this thing to it would be that capsular hooks, iris hooks can use to open up the capsule to but vice to support the capsule, but vice versa is perhaps not true.
Yeah,
but even the iris hooks to support the capsule is not ideal because they just they're not supporting the formix.
So there's a question by Dr. Mayur Parmar. Any special chopper is used or just a Sinsky hook? And the second question is, system is used for injecting IOL. It is being injected in smooth jerks. So
I use a regular sharp chopper, 1.25 mm sharp chopper. I don't change the chopper, but you can use whatever you're comfortable with. You can use a blunt chopper. The second question,
the nucleus, that's what you select, right?
Yeah.
And what light system do you think for injecting the intraocular lens?
Injecting the intraocular lens, you should do it very slowly in a controlled fashion. I use a screw type injector where you have the maximum control. I don't like the shooters because with the hydrophobic lenses, sometimes it suddenly comes out with a jerk and you can damage the capsule or the iris.
And what would be your take on an autocert?
The autocert is good, but it's slow and expensive technology. I think it's an overkill. They have come out with a new lens, the Clarion, which has a CO2 cartridge, which has a controlled injection. So that is something which is interesting. But it has not yet come to India. I saw it during the trade at the AO. So you can see this is again a 68-year-old female with a small pupil. This is a 4 mm pupil. And here I'll and a shallow AC. Sometimes you can have with a shallow AC. So I'm putting xylocaine and adrenaline. Always first do some amount of pharmacological dilatation and then butter charging. Here I'm going to demonstrate the butter charging. So for the butter charging, adequate pupil at least 4 mm. If it's very small, because the ring itself is flexible, and if you have a very small pupil, be able to insert the ring correctly. So this comes here. So you just, this is the Bhattacharji ring made by Suven Bhattacharji from Calcutta, good friend of mine, and an excellent device. The advantage is you can use this even through a 1 mm incision. It's a very thin, flexible segment. Device, and here what I'm doing is visco. The AC is shallowing, it's a shallow AC light, not Ima.
So, I think we should applaud Dr. Suven Bhattacharji for this excellent innovation that he has done for small people, and especially coming from India.
Absolutely.
So it is a great innovation which has been being used worldwide. So, I think do that, and of course, Sri, we have to applaud Sri Ganesh for doing such a fantastic job of surgeries after surgeries with small pupil phaco. I don't know how you collected so many small pupil phacos in a single day, but a great surgical performance.
Thank you. This is, so I've inserted the ring, and you can see this is the new, this is the new design where he has three rings that make it easier to hook the iris. So you can just insert the bullet.
What is the material of this ring?
This is nylon, I believe.
So do you feel it is more flexible as opposed to a Malugan ring?
Yes, this is more flexible. This is more flexible and it is very thin. So unlike a Malugan ring, which needs a larger incision, this can go through a 1 millimeter incision. You can also use forceps. Here I'm just using the this is a small Sinsky like device which comes along with the ring. So disposable. So you can just use this. If you are not very comfortable, you can also use the forceps to insert this. So you can see you get a fairly good pupillary dilatation of about 5 millimeters, 5.5 millimeters here.
So this forms a Heckman sort of a thing for the pupillary dilatation. Rajesh, would you have any experience on Bhattacharjee ring?
Yes, I have, and it works quite well. It is a little softer than the Malugan ring, and but the biggest advantage is that you can insert it through a very small incision, and it can be used with great effect. So, I mean, we can see the surgery that Dr. Sri Ganesh is doing so nicely. The pupil has enlarged well, and
I'm using a Rexus forceps.
Much issues.
I have used Bhattacharjee ring, but I've used the older version. Yeah. So I guess that this is the newer version and he's made some modifications to it.
So you get a nice 6 millimeter. You can get a 6 millimeter, 5 to 6 millimeter Rexus. And that's the hydro. Wait another, you can't a lot. So the advantage is not only pupillary dilatation, but it also holds the pupil and iris in place, prevents it from coming into your port, especially if you have a floppy iris.
Yeah. Another thing that I felt with this ring is that it's not, since it's not bulky, what happens that, you know, I've even tried some other rings like Oasis ring, which has a, you know, bulk in its, you know, the plate that is there, which is enlarging the pupil. So what happens that, you know, sometimes that bulk, because of that bulk, it touches your probe and the whole iris moves along with that. So that's not the case here. And I mean, it's a very good design that has been made by Suvain, our own Suvain Bhattacharjee.
Yeah, and I think he's got a few awards for this. And I've been using this ring. In fact, I've tried all the designs and it works pretty well, especially even for flax when you want to.
Yeah, that is what I wanted to, you know, talk to you, Dr. Sri, that, you know, in flax, if you have a small pupil and if you can insert it to a very small incision, then it works better. You don't have to put the suture.
Yeah, you just make a 1 mm incision, just make the side port and then put it so that the wound stability is better. And this is the advantage to the other rings.
Yeah.
You can use it for flax.
You don't to overfill the viscoelastic. Like I've used my Malugan ring to do flax, but I had to fill it with viscoelastic. So I had to increase the energy of the femtosecond laser for the Rexus and for nucleotomy. So in this case, you may not have to overfill with a high viscosity viscoelastic. So the energy will also be, you know, sort of more or less the same, or maybe marginally more than what you do normally in any other flax.
Do you think
it's less expensive, more affordable than the Malugan ring? So that's the other.
So in floppy iris syndrome, what would be your preference, a Malugan ring or a Bhattacharjee ring or iris hooks?
I mean, both work. I avoid the iris hooks because you can have the floppy iris prolapsing through the side ports, and sometimes it goes and sticks in the side port. I prefer either the Malugan ring or the Bhattacharjee ring for floppy iris. I've used other devices also like OSS ring, but they're like Rajesh said, they are more bulky. chances of touching the endothelium is more while you are inserting or removing, especially
the probe, when you're moving the probe in the anterior chamber, and that causes the whole movement of the this complex, this ring uveal tissue complex.
And this was a shallow, it was a very shallow AC. So when you have a shallow AC, it's better to use a thinner device like the Bhattacharjee ring.
Absolutely.
And that's why I selected the Bhattacharjee ring for this case.
It's a good choice. It's a good choice in such a case.
And removal also is quite easy. In fact, okay, there's a little bit of muck there, which I will just express out. Okay, wait for the lens opens up. Removal is quite easy. All you have to do is just go in with your MacPherson, hold the ring, push it down, and pull it out. So it's very easy to remove the ring. Right. And you can see the pupil comes back to its normal shape.
That was very nice. There is a comment from Dr. Suvan Bhattacharjee himself, who is watching your live surgery, and he says that the new version has sturdy flanges and is easier to handle. And the material is polyamide plastic, and he recommends only the B-hex 23 gauge forceps to be used.
Right,
the manipulator is not provided now.
Okay. So, yeah, now I think with the commercial device, he is not providing the dialer, so you can use the forceps. But it's an excellent device, and I congratulate Suven for his innovation and his gift to ophthalmology.
Many congratulations, Suven.
Congratulations to you, Suven. And we are so happy, Sri Ganesh, that you demonstrated such an elegant use of the Bhattacharjee ring.
So you can see that the chamber is formed very well, just a little bit of hydration of the main incision is adequate. So we'll go on to the last case where I'll demonstrate the Maligan ring.
So there are some questions. We can just take them while you're shifting to the next case.
Sure.
Mohammed Habib wants to know, is hydro stitching required for ports for hooks, or you just leave it as such? So are you hydrating the ports, or you just leave them like this?
I just leave them like that. They're self-sealing like I demonstrated. There is no leak. If there is a leak, then you have to hydrate. In spite of hydration, if there's a leak, then it's better to suture. Wound security is everything. You don't want to compromise on wound security.
The second question by Dr. Nishant is, topical and intracameral anesthesia adequate for iris manipulation? So I think that has been beautifully demonstrated that it doesn't make too much of a difference, and it is adequate for the amount of manipulation that is being done.
Dr. Mukherjee wants to ask you, regarding your experience with these hooks and with these expanders, that is there any damage to the sphincter muscles which may lead to post-op semi-dilated pupil or an irregular pupil?
No, generally the damage is not much. You may have little sphincter damage, but it's not as much as doing a stretch pupilloplasty. So it comes back, like you saw, it comes back to its normal. And post-op, you can't actually make out much of a difference.
Absolutely.
And normally also the post-op, normally also the
have we lost the audio? Hello?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah.
So we're just preparing this case.
Moreover, what I have felt that, you know, with use of these rings like, you know, Melugin or B-hex rings, the sphincter, there's another greater expander. With these expanders, we don't see any significant sphincter damage. With hooks, it may still cause some sphincter damage, but with these rings, it usually doesn't cause any damage to the sphincters. I mean, in majority of cases, most of the cases.
So there's another question for you, meanwhile, Sri Ganesh, and Dr. Meena wants to know if you change the fluidic parameters when using hooks or rings compared to when you're doing viscomydriasis, or there's no difference between the two?
There is no difference between the two. Generally, even either for viscometriosis or, like I said, there are two schools of thought. In a small pupil, you can reduce your flow rate so that you don't catch the iris, especially for beginners. But then advanced surgeons, I don't reduce my parameters because I like the followability. I like to stay in the center and then the fragments. So I'm nowhere near the pupillary margin. That's the advantage of having a higher flow rate. In a floppy iris, again, the iris, if you have a high flow rate, the iris will come towards your phaco tip. So in these cases, if you're not using a device, then you have to lower your flow rate. If you're using a device like the Bhattacharjee or Maligan ring, then it's okay because the device itself will hold the iris apart. And then it will not allow you to allow it to come into your probe. So this is the last case. So this is again about 4 millimeter pupil. And you can see the pseudo exfoliation. Can you see the strands here? This is a case of pseudo exfoliation.
Yeah, we can. We are able to see, you know, the pseudo exfoliation. The pseudo exfoliation material on the pupil.
Yeah. So anyway, you can even do the rexis. It's not very small, but then I will demonstrate the Maligan ring in this case. So this is the Maligan ring, which is the most I think popular device for small pupil, which was made by Boris Maligan, who is a director at the Fedorov Institute. And you can see this is again made of nylon, and it has got 4 loops, and it comes in a preloaded case like this with an injector. So you just have to pull this. It hooks onto the one of the loops, and as you pull the plunger, it loads into the injector. So that's the loading, and then you can just pull it out of this stop. Zero model. Okay. Okay, so inserting the ring, you go in, you engage the pupil at 6 o'clock, on injecting, and then I like to engage it at the 3 o'clock and 9 o'clock positions. Then this is another device which is you get along with the ring, which is like a dialer, and you can use this to just hook on the last part, and you get it in 2 sizes for pupillary dilatation. One is 6 millimeters.
Very elegant engaged, Dr. Shri. Sometimes, you know, it goes a little above the iris, but you know, in one attempt only, every eyelid was very nicely engaged. Yeah. Very elegantly done.
And then you can see you got a nice expansion of the pupil, and you can see the pseudo exfoliation pattern. Can you see it? Yeah, that's the pattern there. So in a pseudo exfoliation case, I like to do a larger capsule or excess. So I always use a ring, either Swen's ring or the Maligan ring, so that I get a large excess. Otherwise, most of these cases go in for capsular contraction, and you can have capsular phimosis. If you try to do the rexis in a small pupil, you'll end up with capsular phimosis and after some time. So that's why I like to do a 5.5 to 6 millimeter rexis. Light, not light. So you can see that's a nice 6 millimeter, 5.5 to 6 millimeter rexis. So these rings basically have made it much easier, life much easier when dealing with, because you can see no extra incision here, And you can also visualize by just pushing to one side, you can even visualize the periphery. Push the ring to one side, you can visualize. So this is again a softer cataract. So I'll show you a mechanical chop. So this is mechanical chop. You can see that there is no vacuum. I just go in and then chop. You can see it's a through and through chop. There is no vacuum, no flow. That's a mechanical chop. Of course, with this, you can use some amount of phaco. It is not that soft. But for softer cataracts, either a mechanical chop or a vacuum chop is ideal. So once the Marigan ring came in, it made a big difference to managing intraop floppy iris syndrome. Patients with ampicillosin.
We have to check. We have to check for the signal. So can somebody check for the signal, please? Okay, now we are there again. So the signal has come back.
You can see that there's excellent chamber stability.
I think one thing that has been clearly demonstrated in all these cases is the chamber stability. I mean, the anterior chamber has been just, you know, rock stable. You can say it has not moved at all, whether it was the beginning of the surgery or the end of the surgery. And I think that credit goes to the Signature Pro machine that you're using. And of course, to your expertise for having to control all the parameters like yourself on the foot pedal.
So this is, of course, you can see the IA also is pretty fast and you have a good exposure. So you can do a thorough cortical cleanup. You can see that was the IA. And I like to do some amount of capsular polishing so that I have a very clean capsule. You can see the nice rexus now. I'm using a Technis 1 lens again in this case. Of course, there are other devices and other techniques. The simplest, like I said, was stretch pupilloplasty. But I think that is very simple and most people do it. I didn't demonstrate it. That's something that is routinely used. So once the lens is in, then you have to remove the Maligan ring. This is my technique of removal. I kind of draw it in the same injector. I go in first and then just unhook the proximal part of it. Go in and then feed it in and then just go on. Okay, it's quite easy. And see, the pupil comes back to its normal.
That's perfect. That's perfect.
Okay. Remove the viscoelastic. You can see the pupil has come down now.
Yeah, absolutely. We can see that very beautifully demonstrated. Dr. Sri, Dr. Rajesh Jain has congratulated you for doing wonderful surgeries.
Thank you. And I hope it is useful and people have learned something from this session on how to manage small pupils and phaco.
Many things, not just something. Many things. Yeah. Very beautiful tips, wonderful one tips in your surgery is very nicely demonstrated.
It was almost like a textbook, a picture or demonstration of all the devices and all the techniques and the tips that you told us for small pupil phaco emulsification.
Thank you, Dr. Namrata. And if there are any questions, we can take that. So that was the end of the surgery sessions. We did 5 surgeries and demonstrated different techniques. Yeah, now I think we can just discuss. Kanbadi, sir.
So there's one question from Dr. Preeti Shinde, and she wants to know if there are any expert comments for wound hydration for the novice phaco surgeons.
wound hydration again is a temporary thing. What you have to realize is the wound hydration does not actually give security to the wound. So primarily it's the wound construction. So when you do a proper wound construction, there will be no leak. So when you make your incision and you put pressure on the cornea, you will see there's no leak if your incision is. You need to hydrate your incision only because you have put in instruments and stretched the incision. Because of the stretch, until the fibers come back to its normal shape, the hydration itself will close the wound. So it's a temporary thing which lasts for a few hours. So the technique of hydration, again, I like to inject into the side wall of the incision. Because if you inject upwards, then there is a higher risk of desmase detachment, especially in older patients. So if you inject to the side, into the wall, into the stroma, then you are away from the desmans incisions there, and then the risk of desmans detachment is less. So that is my technique which you saw. I don't hydrate the side ports because basically I have not stretched the side port. So I don't need to hydrate the side port. If you are using bimanual IA, then you have stretched the side ports and you have to hydrate. For bimanual IA, you have to hydrate the wound and see that it is closed. Even after hydration, if there is a wound leak, if you are in doubt, you can just put some sterile fluorescein and see, do a seedles. If there is a leak, then it is better to suture. So don't hesitate to suture the wound. See, you may have promised the patient, I'm going to do a sutureless surgery, and you may be hesitant to suture the wound. But if you do not suture the wound, you can have a flat AC. You have a higher risk of endophthalmitis. So it's always important to maintain the wound integrity. So when in doubt, you suture. But ideally, if you are good at your wound construction, then minimal hydration and your wound should be stable.
So thank you so much, Sri Ganesh, for letting us peep into your operation theater today. Not only us, but all the AIOS members who wish to see your operation theater. And they so they
and of
they
course actually, your surgery as well.
Yeah, your, they actually, you know, they saw how effortlessly you do the surgeries under topical anesthesia without any hesitation at all. And thank you so much for doing this today for us.
Thanks a
thank
lot.
You, thank you. And I enjoy demonstrating the surgery. Thank you very much. Bye, everybody.
Thank you. And we would also at this point in time like to thank Johnson & Johnson for their support for this activity. This was the second Surginar today that we did, and every month we are going to do a Surginar. So every month there will be another subject to tackle with. And thank you, Mr. Jaswinder, Mr. Manish, and Mr. Himanshu from J&J for coordinating this and for organizing this. Thank you, Sri Ganesh, again. And thanks to all the Netradhama OT team, your nursing staff, your technicians, your assistants who made this happen. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thanks.